Good morning, everyone. I once again welcome you to the second day of the online lecture series titled Productive Engagement of University Teachers and Research Scholar during COVID-19 lockdown. Commissioner cum Secretary Srijukta Shashwat Mishra, IAS, and he delivered the inaugural address followed by a mind-blowing, mesmerizing lecture delivered by our revered Professor Ashok Das, former Vice Chancellor of Utkal University and current Vice Chairman of Odisha State Higher Education Council. So today, you know, I would like to welcome our speaker, Professor Athanu Kumar Pathy, the Vice Chancellor of GM University. And before introducing him, I would also like to welcome all the Honorable Vice Chancellor and senior bureaucrats who have been attending this lecture series since yesterday. But I would like to, you know, give some tips to the participant. There are a lot many dislocation and disturbance yesterday. So participant, please listen to me carefully. I repeat, please listen to me carefully. Mute the microphone and turn off the camera during the talk. Okay? And the second instruction, don't press the present now button during the talk. This is very, very important. Listen carefully. This will disrupt the meeting and lead to your removal. We'll be forced to remove you. And that is why you should be careful. And if you have any question, please ask question in brief in the chat box. Okay. We will not allow you to put question directly. And mentioning your name, when you are writing there, you mention your name, designation and affiliation. Your question will be asked by to the speaker by our moderator after the presentation is over. So that is how we'll proceed, and the lectures are also live on Facebook. And with this brief note, I would like to welcome again our speaker, revered speaker, Professor Pathy. And I shall fail in my duty if I don't introduce him. Professor Athanu Kumar Pathy, the Vice Chancellor of Gangadhar Mehr University, is an eminent chronobiologist and physiologist. The importance of his research and value of his distinguished teaching career cannot be articulated by a brief introduction. Probably I am incompetent. Let me try. Professor Pathy's research on cardinal clocks in shift workers, cancer patients, and patients suffering from metabolic disorder has been internationally acclaimed. Professor Pathy completed his undergraduate in zoology from Utkal University. Subsequently, he joined the Faculty of Biological Science at Pandit Ravi Shankar Shukla University. He was a postdoctoral fellow at the Hospital Paul Broussy, Paris, during 1985-86. While as a professor at Pandit Ravi Shankar Shukla University, he successfully guided 23 PhD students and ran 14 research projects sponsored by different funding agencies. Professor Pathy has served as a member of several academic committees across the country. In recognition of his seminal research contribution, he has been elected Fellow of National Academy of Science, India, National Academy of Medical Sciences, India. He is also the first fellow of the Indian Society for Chronomedicine. It is indeed the good fortune of Gangadhar Mehr University that since July 2017, it has been in the able hands of such an eminent academician, like as Professor Pathy, who never compromises with academic standard. Under his leadership, Gangadhar University looks very promising. With these few words, I would like to invite Professor Pathy to deliver his landed speech. Professor Pathy, now Google Meet platform is yours.
Good morning to all the viewers, and all the people who are viewing this lecture. So, you know, the title of my presentation is Research Paper Writing and Publications. So, before presenting, I would just like to reveal my sources. So you can see that I have taken materials from Scopus, Elsevier, National Sleep Foundation, and one book, you know, How to Publish Your Journal Paper, and many other components from the internet. And also, I have taken some important correspondences between editors of journals and the authors. So this is the disclaimer. Apologies to all if I am saying anything wrong or anything accurate or anything incomplete. So now the first question that comes to our mind, do we need to write and publish research articles? My answer is yes. And I have divided it into three different categories why we need to do research, why we need to publish papers. Now, look at the first one, that is personal. The first one is job, then research score and academic score. You know that while people are applying for academic positions, as per the UGC guidelines, they have to score, say, for example, if you are associate professor, you have to score 75. And if you are professor, you have to score at least 120. So therefore, it is important. Then promotion, that means when one is promoted from assistant professor to associate professor and from associate professor to professor. So we need to have this data that how much we have published and in what kind of journals we have published. So, but I have put a question mark, career advancement scheme. The reason is that this is not being very religiously followed in Odisha so far. Now, the another point is that self-satisfaction. That means you are disseminating knowledge to the students, to the society. And then incentivization. This is another important point that you may like to get some incentives if you are writing papers. Now I'll share just one screen that the cash bonuses for peer-reviewed papers go global. If you look at the China, it is offering a lot of money, $1,65,000 if someone is publishing in Science or Nature. So with this background, we had a meeting with Dr. Ashok Das at the Bhubaneswar, and then we have decided that in Odisha also we need to incentivize, not equivalent to what China is doing, but at least if someone is publishing going to publish a paper in a good journal, 50% cost will be borne by the government of Odisha. So that was a very welcome step adopted by government of Odisha. And this is already in practice. And all those people, especially I'm referring to the research scholars and young faculties, if they have difficulty in paying the amount for their paper, say for example, PLOS group of journals. So they're all paid journals, but they are very good journals. PLOS one is most popular than any PLOS group of journals. So this is a very important thing that I congratulate Government of Odisha Higher Education Department and especially Professor Ashok Das for his initiatives in this direction. So now come to the institutional. How will benefit the institution by writing papers? You know that NAC, NIRF, DSTPs, UGC SAP, RUSA, World Bank, everywhere you need to show your publication footprint and what is the citations of your papers. All these are important. Therefore, writing papers are important. Then when you come to the extramural project, this is extremely important. Everybody looks at your data, that what, how many papers you have published. So then you come to the third column. If you want to see India as a powerful country, then it is our moral responsibility that we should publish very good papers and do very good research. And I will give why it is important in subsequent slides. Now look at this slide. Now if you look at the number of science and engineering articles published in peer-reviewed journals, then you'll be surprised that China has surpassed the United States with a contribution, global share of 20.67%, whereas the United States is having a share of 16.54%. And India is occupying the third position. But look at the share. It is only 5.31%. This is the reason why we want to write papers. Now, this is another thing, that internationally mobile students enrolled in tertiary education by selected country. This data from National Sleep Foundation, National Science Foundation, and you will find that India's name is not there. So this is an important issue to be handled. Now I have tried to compare at least three countries with reference to the documents. Here documents means good research papers that is in index journals. And this data I take from the Scopus. So therefore you can consider that this is based on the Scopus cited journals. So now if you look at the first slide, then you will see that how the China is rising. You know, the green one is India, the blue one is China, and the brown one is United States. Now look at the arts and humanities. In arts and humanities also, the India is behind China. Now look at the material science. It's very interesting. The China has surpassed United States of America. And in social science, China is well above India. So these are the issues, you know. These are the matters to consider very seriously. And at a given point of time, India was above China. And if you look the data carefully. Now I come to the our Odisha University data. So I have taken, you know, all the state universities that is under the Higher Education Department. And you look at the first line graph, this is for Kurukshetra University. So why I have chosen Kurukshetra University? Because Kurukshetra University is occupying a position that is 98th position in the NIRF list of 2019. The NIRF list of 2020 is, you know, it is not yet published because of corona crisis. Now the second line, that is for the Utkal University. And it, you can see the difference between the Kurukshetra University, that is a state university, and all other universities of Odisha. That is a huge gap. So that means we have to reduce this gap. And if you have to reduce this gap, we have to publish good papers. Now this is the same story, but I have given the figures, you know, that how many papers in total they have published. You see, that is 5,314 articles in the name of Kurukshetra University. And this is Utkal University, Sambalpur, Barhampur, Revansa, FMU, GMU, AU, and RDU Men's University. So these three are new universities. And the FMU is also relatively new university. And then I didn't find scope of space for North Odisha University, then OSU, and Sanskrit University. This has to be taken very seriously. Why the pages are not there in the scopus? I may be wrong with him, but the authorities should try to see that what is happening with these three universities. Now I have compared the citation report, citation footprint of all the universities, state universities, whose scopus pages are available. Then if you look at the last 3 years, don't look at the drop, that is the 2020. 2020 is not yet completed. But this is a very healthy trend. In all the universities, you find that the graph is increasing. And this is very good. Now I have compared the H index of all the universities. And you will find that Utkal University has a H index of 81, that is the highest. So now, then why the Utkal University is not occupying a position in the NIRF within 100? That is a question. Everybody should think in this direction. What is happening? Why it is not occupying a position? And as compared to other state universities, Utkal University has a very good H index, that is 81. Now see, I just gave you a background that why you should publish. That will benefit personally to an individual, and then that will benefit the institution, and that will also benefit the country. So you should think very seriously in this direction. Then I am just changing the gear. Now I need to say that very interesting researches are going on. So I have picked up a couple of very unusual researches, and that I believe that research scholars will be keen to see all these interesting areas, very unusual researches. So now you see that one is, I wanted to say that I just want to share with the audience, especially the research scholars and young teachers, that research is going on in very interesting areas. Someone is asking a question, why the dog has a curved tail, right? Now we know this activity. I think all of us might have done once or twice or maybe many times in our life. So now you see. Now this particular paper that received the Ig Nobel Prize, and this research is done in Bangalore, that for probing medical discovery that nose picking is a common activity among adolescents. So this is for the research scholars specifically. They should browse this site, Annals of Improbable Research. And first people start laughing, but when they think very seriously, then they find that this is very interesting research. So now look at this research. All mammals empty their bladders in about 21 seconds, plus minus 13 seconds. You look at the animals, starting from mouse to elephant. So this is very interesting. And this work was done by colleagues from the physics department and biomedical engineering department. Now I just want to give a message that if you are doing a lot of research and putting all the data inside this box and putting a lock, it is as good as not doing any research. So what is important is that your box should be empty. All the data that you have got, that should be published. So this is the message I want to give. Now, there is a very famous saying, publish or perish, refers to the pressure to publish work constantly to further or sustain a career in academia. A scholarly writer may experience pressure to publish constantly regardless of academic field in which the writer conducts scholarship. Now, writing a paper is a very daunting task. Maybe you have carried out path-breaking innovative research. What will happen if the paper is not correctly written? So at best, your competition will be here. And in the worst scenario, the work will never be published. Therefore, writing a research paper is a very, very, you know, tricky job. So there are many elements in writing an article. The number one comes into mind, that is the ethical issues, style and language, structure of the paper, components of a paper, article submission, journal selection, publisher's process, and peer review. All these are very important elements while writing a paper. In the ethical issues, you know, the first thing that comes into mind, the disclosure of conflict of interest, acknowledgement of funding resources, plagiarism certification. Then, nowadays, most of the journals, they want supplemental information. That is when you are doing the online submission. And for health sciences, you know, submission of a clinical trials to a central registry. Then institutional review board for approval. All these are important. And I have the links here. And anybody who wants to know the details can browse the link and get to it. Now the style and language. The object, what is the author's style? The object, report your findings clearly and as concisely as possible. Avoid ornamentation with unnecessary words or phrases. And always prefer to write in active voice and use very short sentences. And passive voice is big no. So for example, carbon dioxide was consumed by the plant. Instead, you write, plant consumed carbon dioxide. The best one is the last one, that plant consumed carbon dioxide. Now, how tenses are most often used in writing papers? No facts and hypotheses. It should be written in the present tense. Suppose someone is writing, the average life expectancy of Indians is 75 years. So it's a present tense. Now, when you refer to the experiments you have already conducted, so you can write in past tense. For example, all the fruit flies were maintained in a chamber with a consistent temperature of 23 degrees Celsius. So this one is in passive voice. So if you want to write it in active voice, then you write, we maintain fruit flies in a chamber with consistent temperature of 23 degrees. Now when you describe results of an experiment, it is again in the past tense. The average life expectancy of fruit flies in our sample was 6 weeks. This is not passive voice, this is active voice. So this is very important. Then write clearly. There is no substitute for a good idea, for excellent research, or for good, clean, or clear writing. Grammar mistakes or gross violations of APA style, such mistakes do give the impression that you are not careful. Get a pre-review to the journal. You should share your paper with two people, at least one who is very familiar, with your research area, and another who is not familiar. While the latter can determine whether your ideas are becoming communicated clearly, who is not a technical person. So now you know, in many journals, they request the author to submit an article in 3 steps. The first is that upload your manuscript, upload your cover letter, and upload your supporting information. Then their editorial board that examines and then decides whether that should be sent for the review or not. So many journals now they are adopting this principle. So that saves a lot of time. So this is I have picked up from the plus one. Now there are six steps in writing. That is pre-writing, drafting, revising, pre-reviewing, editing, and presenting. These are the six important steps in writing. Now, if you look at the structure of the article, so scientific writing follows a rigid structure, a format developed over 100 of years. Consequently, a paper can be read at several levels. Some people just will refer to the title. So that means they never read the abstract or your paper. They make a decision by just reading your title. So therefore, it is very important. Title is very important. And many others, they read your title as well as your abstract. And then they don't read further. So that means, first thing is title is important. Second thing is the abstract is extremely important. Others will read the paper for a deeper understanding. But that percentage of people in the third category is very less. So now, title should be very clearly defined. And author recognition, that is the affiliation and everything. And the abstract describes concisely what was done. And keywords ensures that the article is correctly identified in abstracting and indexing databases. So therefore, keywords are very important. That means when most of the people should be able to see your work, you should choose the keyword in such a way. Now, if you go to the main text, most of the article you will find there are four things are there basically: introduction, title, results, and discussion. Put the work into context in the introduction. Explains how the data were collected in the method, and describes what was discovered in the results, and discusses implications of the findings in discussion. So then we have other things also, as I said earlier also, that is acknowledgments, references, supplementary materials. Many journals now ask for supplementary materials. So then another question that comes to your mind, that what type of article or what type of manuscript? So there are different types, you know. One is letters, rapid, short communications, review and perspectives, book review, and symposium report or conference report. These are different types. So then there is slight differences, you know, how to write, you know, different type of articles. And that I'm not going to discuss at length. Now the process of publishing, the process remains unchanged, irrespective of the type of manuscript, mostly. So now if you see the publication cycle, then you see that communication, research discovery is the first point, going through the clockwise direction, then the communication, submission, peer review, publication, and novel ideas for furtherance of research. That means you, in your paper, you write something, you give some directions to the future research. Now, components of paper. I have already discussed, so I want to skip on this slide. Now, authors listing. Only include those who have made intellectual contribution to the research, or those who will publicly defend the data and conclusions, and who have approved the final version. Order of the names of the authors can vary from discipline to discipline. In some fields, the corresponding author's name appears first. So this is very, very variability there. Lot of variability there. But there are different type of authors also. I am not going to detail into it. Say, for example, guest author and ghost author. Ghost author means the real person who has worked in everything, done everything, but his name is missing from the paper. So they are called as the ghost authors. Okay. So notes on authorship, So number of authors per paper, some people ask that how many authors should be, you know, there in a paper. Then honorary authorship, that means director of the institution get authorship in all the papers. You know, ghost authorship, ghost writer. Ghost writer means who writes the paper, but his name is never appears in the paper. Order of authors in a list is very important. And there are many papers or articles you'll find that unclaimed authorship or anonymous. So now just I give one example that how big could be the author's list. Now I see that in a clinical trial study published in New England Journal, there are 972 authors. In another study in 2008, Large Hadron Collider article, that is having 2,926 authors. So that is, it's a very interesting thing. Notes on authorship, anonymous and unclaimed authorship. The best example is your student t-test. The actual writer is William Gossett, who was forced to publish his work in statistics under the pseudonym student. So when I ask students that why it is called student's t-test, some student interestingly answered that because student used it while sipping tea. So now the title is very important. I just go repeating in a larger way. So title describes the paper's content clearly and precisely, including keywords. Many journals, they say that if you are given keywords, those keywords should not appear on the title. And there is a lot of variation depending upon the journal. So that means title is the advertisement for the article. So you have to take it very seriously. Do not use any abbreviations or jargon on the title. It is very simple. Jargon free, no abbreviation. Search engines, indexing databases depend on the accuracy of the title, since they use the keywords to identify relevant articles. So in some journals, there is restriction on the words also, that you have to write the title using, say, 15 words. So that restriction the author has to take care. Now the abstract is the mirror. It is the mirror of your article. And that reflects the entire article in a very small way. So that briefly summarizes. Many journals, they have restriction on words. Some say that 150 words, 200 words, 250 words, that is a very great variation. So because you know that I have already said that many people read the abstract, then they leave the paper, they leave the article. So that means the abstract should be very interesting so that your reader that goes into your paper and studies the detail what you have done. That means together the title and the abstract should stand on their own. Many authors write the abstract last, so that it accurately reflects the content of the paper. Introduction. It clearly states the problem being investigated, background that explains the problem, reasons for the conducting the research, summarize relevant research to provide context, state how your work differs from the published work, identify the questions you are answering. Explain what other findings, if any, you are challenging or extending. And briefly describe the experimental hypothesis, research questions, experimental design or method. But remember that reviewing of the literature before you write the paper is very important. Otherwise, every morning you will become an Einstein. You will think that you are doing something which is extraordinary innovative, because you are simply ignorant about the history of the subject you are working on. Methods: provide the reader enough details so that they can understand and replicate your research. Explain how you studied the problem, identify the procedures you followed, and order this chronologically where possible. Explain new methodology in detail. Otherwise, name the method and cite the previously published work. Include the frequency of observations, what types of data were recorded, etc. Be precise in describing measurements and include errors of measurement or research design limits. Results: objectively present your findings and explain what was found, so that your new results are contributing to the body of scientific knowledge. Follow a logical sequence based on the tables and figures, presenting the findings to answer the question or hypothesis. Figures should have a brief description and legend, providing the reader sufficient information to know how the data were produced. Discussion and conclusion: of what was already known about the subject, indicate how the results relate to expectations and to the literature previously cited. Explain how the research has moved the body of scientific knowledge forward. Do not extend your conclusions beyond what is directly supported by your results. Avoid undue speculation. Outline the next steps for further study. So these are the references. There are different style of references, and it is very subject specific. You know, the arts and humanities, they follow a particular pattern. There are different patterns that depends upon the journal. So accordingly, you have to prepare your references first. The bibliography, you know, we have Harvard style, Vancouver style, then we have many other different styles are mentioned here, and you know, in subject wise they are very different. Now I'll give you specifically, I'm telling this to the new the research scholars, the young people. Nowadays many journals, they welcome graphical abstract. That means no words are written there, only to the graphical abstract. And we call this as nowadays infographics, abstract in the form of infographics. So I'll just give few examples that the work we did in Sambalpur, that we try to see that there is a well-established Gaussian distribution of chronotype, phenotype in humans. So we did study in the tribal belt of Western Odisha, then we found that we can able to challenge this established norm, the Gaussian distribution of chronotype, because in rural Western Odisha, the indigenous people, they are 99% morning time, whereas the established literature says that intermediate time, they occupy the higher frequency as compared to the night active and morning active time. So here we call it as the cock type or the owl type. Owl type means evening active, and the cock type means they are morning active. So this is an infographic abstract. I gave one example. I'll give another example that we are studying rural population, and we are trying to find out that what are the variability in the sleep pattern in the rural population. Then we discovered that the sleep quality of the rural people is excellent, and there is almost zero social jet lag. All of you must be knowing jet lag, that when we are flying from, say, Sambalpur to London, so our clock will be, you know, synchronized with the Sambalpur time. When we reach in the London, then our clock, body clock is advanced. So we feel very discomfort, that is known as social jet lag. Actual jet lag. But here we are talking about a social jet lag. The individual is not going anywhere, but there are two different patterns that is emerging. One is on the work day, another is on the free day. So free day means for us, for working people, maybe the Saturday and Sunday, In many offices are closed on Saturday. So Saturday and Sunday could be considered as free days, and the other weekdays are work days. So you'll find that there is a difference. Now see in the middle, this is the semi-urban area. That means on the work day, on the free day, we are talking about the mid-sleep time, and there is a time lag. And this time lag is 9.6 minutes. And if you see the urban area, this time lag is increasing, 13.8. But believe me, this is not pathological. And this is absolutely normal and well-accepted social jet lag. So this is an example of how we can write an abstract using the infographics. Then I'll talk about the video abstract. Now we have whole range of video journals where you don't have to write anything. You have to present your paper, your article in the form of a video. And I have hyperlinked here, but because of the constraint of time, I'll not go into the details that how video abstract or video journals are working. Now you see, this is the video journals. They have a large number of subject areas where they are accepting papers in the video mode. Now, article submission. It is very important thing that select your journal carefully. Read the aims and scope. Think about your target audience. Follow the guidelines. And articles should not be submitted to more than one journal at a time. This is a very ethical issue. Many people, what they do, they submit their articles simultaneously to three journals. And sometimes, you know, two journals, they accept it. Then where to publish? This is a very embarrassing situation. So online submission, now most of the journals, they are practicing this online submission. And after submission, you know, there are, you know, a lot of processes referring speed tremendously vary between journals. So you should carefully monitor that what is the referring speed of different journals. And we have submitted one paper about 7 months ago, and still we do not hear anything from the journal. So we should avoid this kind of journal. That is the message I want to give. So then you see, this is the review process, and all of you know, so I don't want to go into the details. I go to the next. Pre-publication peer review. This is important. Because most of the journals, most of the good journals, they do pre-publication peer review. And we should be knowing that what are the important things, what are the outcome of those reviews. They will say accept, which almost nobody gets. Okay, accept with revision, just make some minor changes. And revise and resubmit. They are still interested in you. That means from this message, you can understand, the author can understand what is the real status of your paper. And then it may be reject and resubmit. Though not as good as revise and resubmit, they still want the paper. So these are the message from where you can understand that what is going to happen with your paper. So, but don't panic. Only a small proportion of papers, 5 to 10%, are accepted the first time they are submitted. And usually they are only accepted subject to revision. So if rejected, don't worry. Send it to the another journal. Now see, this is our paper. We submitted in Current Science. It was rejected with a very bad comment. So we sent the journal to an American Journal of Insect Behavior, with a better impact factor. And it was accepted. So don't worry. So in the paper I was referring just now, that has undergone three revisions. First revision, second revision, third revision, and finally it was accepted. So I have all the copies with me, but because of constraint of time, I have hyperlinked all the question answer with the reviewers, but time constraint is important. So questions reviewers, what they ask, does the paper fit the standards and scope of the journal? This is the first question. Second question is the research question clear? Was the approach appropriate? Then third, is the study design, methods and analysis appropriate to the question being studied? Are the methods described clearly enough for other researchers to replicate? These are the questions reviewers ask. So are the methods statistical analysis and level of significance appropriate? Could presentation of the results be improved? And do they answer the question? In humans, human tissues or animals are involved, was ethics approval gained? And was the study ethical? Are the conclusions appropriate? These are the important questions. So we have to ready while writing a paper. So now the publication tips. So there are, you know, in summary, you see that what is the motivation to publish, author's perspective. So 50% first choice is the dissemination of knowledge. And first choice of 20% is career prospects. And first choice of 11% is improved funding. And first choice of 8% is ego. And first choice of 4% is patent protection. And others is 3%. So this is very important to see. So now, what are the author publishing priorities? Number one is quality and speed. Top items were referring speed, referring standard, and general reputation. Then how to know the general reputation? There is one metric, general metrics, but the important general impact factor. From there, one can assess, but that is not absolutely correct. So then second is editor board, physical quality of publication and services. These are the things, you know, priorities. Readers' priorities. Earlier one is the author's priorities. Now readers' priorities are different. That the article should be authoritative, easy to access, rapid delivery, convenient format, linking of information and clustering, low or no cost, up-to-date information. These are the readers' priorities. Now if you compare author behavior with the reader behavior, then you'll find the principal difference is author wants to publish more and reader want to read less. So therefore you have to be very careful. That means you write your paper in such a way that your article is picked up for reading. So now differences between authors and readers is authors are general focused, readers are article focused. Publish more, read less dichotomy between the authors and the readers. So now choosing the right journal, this is a message for young research scholars and young faculties that while picking up your journal, so you should be very careful because in India we have a already standardized system that we call as UGC CARE journals. We should see that you are sending your article to a journal which is listed in the UGC CARE. So UGC CARE automatically covers Scopus, Web of Science, and most of the important academy journals. So there is nothing to worry. But you should understand that all Scopus journals are not index journals. That means when I say SCI journals, that is Science Citation Index Journal, now it has become Science Citation Index Expanded and Social Science Citation Index, Arts and Humanities Citation Index Journals. So journals may be there listed in the Scopus, cited in the Scopus, but it may not be there in the SCI or SSCI or AMHCI. So you have to be careful before choosing the journal. The best way is that you choose the journals which are considered as index journals, and that you can find in the Thomson Reuters pages. And this is the message for the young research scholars and young faculties. Now, how to, as I said, that there is a journal metric and that is a journal impact factor. So it is a very simple arithmetic formula to calculate the impact factor. I have just given an example for you. that is citations in 2019 to article published in 2018, 187 citations, and 2017 it received 318 citations. Then sum of citations is 505, and number of articles published in 2018 is 54 articles in that journal, and 2017 that is 46 articles in that journal. So that makes it 100 articles. So it's very simple formula: 505 divided by 100. The impact factor of the journal is 5.05. So now this is the first article. This is the HIST JEE. He's basically by training a physics person, but his physics papers are less popular than this paper, which is published in PNAS. And look at the abstract, only one sentence. I have never seen such a brief abstract in any, for any papers. It is a single sentence, and this is the most popular paper of HIST. So H index stands for HIST index. So therefore we call it as H index, because this is proposed by J.E. HIST. So then there is Google Scholar Metrics. I don't want to go into details. So you can find in Google Scholar pages, H5 index. From there you can find out the journals, which are important. And you can also find out H5 median for journals. Now I have just taken yesterday night. This is the latest figure, that what are the most 10 important journals in the area of life science and art sciences. So you can see that the blue letter is H5 index, and H5 median is in the red, and these are the top 10 journals. So that you can get it in details in the Google Scholar pages. So what is the take home message? How to submit a journal article, read the instructions, format manuscript, send the manuscript, all the, you know, wait for the reviewers' comments, address all the comments of the reviewers, then keep to the deadline, return the revised manuscript timely, then read proof sent by the editor, ensure that everything is okay, return the proof back to the editor before deadline, all these things, you know, complete and return copyright form to the editor, wait to see the article in print or online. If the manuscript is rejected at the peer review level, revise it using a reviewer's comments and send it to another journal. But if it is repeatedly rejected by 3, 4, 5, 6 journals, then you put your article in the dustbin. Now see, I am going into a different area now. Now you can see this Hindustan Times deals, Delhi school children shop online to complete their homework. Now see another interesting, this is writing services. Now see this, no time to polish your text, so you please send your data to us. We'll write your paper in 3 days and take $48.5. And if you want within 24 hours, we'll take $74.03. And if you want 76 minutes, you have to pay $380.39. So I just give two important papers that we are, one is already published and one we are working on. That very interesting work. If you look at the publication history, this paper we sent on 28th November and the journal accepted it on 2nd of December. So now if you look at the title of the paper, habitual daily good morning message senders reveal the status of their own circadian clock. That means this is the very single and only publication in the world where the good morning messages that we receive in our WhatsApp account, we have used that good morning messages and calculated that how the circadian clock of the sender, whether it is working perfectly, whether it is synchronized perfectly or not. This is a very interesting work, and it not a single pie is involved for carrying out this research. Now the second work I would like to, which we are working on. So one of my colleague, Dr. Nakul Chaudhary, I visited his garden, then I found this hibiscus mutabilis. In Odia, we call it as Stola Padma. And very interestingly, this flower changes its color from morning to the day and to the night. That means in the morning, it is white in the morning, changes to pink as the day progresses, and become deep red in the evening. and the red flowers possess the maximum antioxidant properties. It's a very simple experimental design. We put the cameras there and we continuously monitor for 10 days that how the changes of the color is taking place, and during different time of the color phase, how different pollinators are visiting this insect. And then further research we are planning to do is to identify the antioxidant properties when the color of the flower are different. I just gave an example that with very minimum expenditure, with minimum efforts, we can do very wonderful research. This is a message to the not to the honorable vice chancellors, but to the research scholars and young faculty. So enforcing this Mr. S.M. Patroy, that publish or perish with a gun. Now this is a cartoon diagram to say that, but what I want to say that you please publish and flourish. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Thank you very much, Professor Pathy, for your marvelous speech, which was quite informative, and you have given lot many tips, especially to the young scholar and those who are at the entry level of teaching profession. Violently, I really enjoyed listening to your lecture. Publish or perish. If we are in teaching profession, we have to publish, and it is a must. And when we publish, we should be careful. We should be careful in terms of selecting journal, and we should only think of publishing our article in peer-reviewed journal. And rightly said by you, publication is a daunting task. It's not easy. Sometimes we take it lightly, and we are very careless. Sometimes our papers are completely incomplete, and we are very casual. That's why our papers are not accepted by standard journal. So thanks, Professor Pathy, for giving so many important tips. And I'm sure all participants will be happy to know, sir, you'll be happy to know that 246 participants, 251, to correct, 251. Our limit is 250, so 251 attended your lecture. So big congratulations as organizer, and on behalf of everybody, I would like to extend my well thanks. Now it's time for our moderator. We have received many questions. Be ready. So our moderator will shoot you with many questions. Okay, just our moderator,
Professor.
From the Department of English will ask you a question. We have detected some question.
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much, Professor Pathy, for this wonderful lecture, sir. We are very obliged to you. And this lecture is very useful, and the suggestions are very handy. And I guess this bottom line, publish or flourish, must have gone into the minds of our young researchers. Without much ado, we'll be taking a few questions. And we will not be able to cover all questions, except that we have been very selective about the most relevant questions. And one of them is, why have you rated UGC CARE journals more than SCI group of journals? Please offer your comments.
All the index journals are there within the UGC CARE. Did you understand? All the journals are there within the UGC CARE.
I guess the person who asked the question must have got this answer. All right. Now, there is one more question, whether ethical approval is compulsory in all paper publications. This is a question from a researcher.
You see, the ethical approval is important. If you are doing research using the humans, If you are doing research using the animals, then there is the animal ethics committee. And it should be there in all the institutions. At Gangadhar Mehr University, we have recently introduced that institutional ethics committee for human research. Even people are using questionnaires. They have to undergo the whole process, presenting their findings before the ethics committee. And once it is approved, they can carry out the research. That means simply asking questions is also sometimes embarrassing. And that creates problem with the ethics and values. So now at Gangadhar Mehr University, we are in the process of establishing another ethics committee for the animal research. That means if you are using animals, then whether we are doing ethical practices in the research or not. And even for plant research in India, I didn't find any ethical committee for plant research. But in Western countries, we have ethical committee for plant research and microbe research as well. That is, whatever research we are doing, that should be passed through an ethical committee.
Okay, the next question.
The next question is there any existing guidelines as to how to prepare infographic abstract which you talked about?
That there is guidelines, and these guidelines differ from one journal to another journal. Okay, so then the author has to read the instruction to the authors, and there they can find that what should be the pixel size, and every details are given in the journals. There is guideline.
Now, don't you think by insisting upon publish and perish and this quick method of achieving career promotion compromises the quality of original research?
I don't think so. Publishing quickly never compromises your quality or anything, because you might have seen in many journals, Nature, Science, and many journals plus series, they do the reviewing work very quickly. So there is no problem.
And perhaps the last question, sir. So, how to strike a balance among teaching, research, and administrative responsibilities in the Orissa universities?
You see, the human mind is very important. You yourself will decide how to strike a balance between all these three things. Because in an institution, when you are a teacher, you have to carry out some administrative responsibility as well. And then you have to carry out research, you have to carry out teaching responsibility. When I was at Pandit Ravi Shankar Shukla University, I was director of the IQAC. I was director of National Center for Natural Resources. And I was a professor taking regularly classes. And then a lot of administrative responsibility. So it is possible. The willpower is very important.
Thank you very much, sir, for giving us your valuable time and addressing very important issues with regard to quality publications. Thank you very much, sir.
If you have to do a kind of summing up a few more extra tips to the young budding researcher, especially the research scholar in different universities, they are listening to your lecture. So what kind of tips because they need quick publication, because it's question of their career, but you ask them to select the journal and go for quality publication, and that's time consuming. So there is a contradiction. It seems paradoxical. How can a young scholar would wait that long to get his article published in a peer reviewed journal, and you have a standard prescription, like you have 2 marks for international publication and 1 mark for national publication. Now the young scholar is totally confused how he will score marks. He or she will not be able to meet the APA score, and you talk about quality publication. I agree whatever has been said, and that is the real tips, but how the young researcher who is struggling hard to make a breakthrough would meet this requirement?
All right. Now listen, actually, I'll just share my own habits, because I have published 104 papers which are listed in Scopus. and all of them are cited in the index journals, that is in the Web of Science. So therefore, what is my habit? I always try to see the record of that journal before sending a paper. That what is the receipt date of the article and what is the acceptance date of the article. On the basis of these two input, I decide where to send the paper. And I always like those journals which do things very quickly. When you need a publication as soon as possible. You cannot wait. You see, one journal, we have recently sent a paper and it has already taken 7 months. So this is horrible. So the message to the student is that they should review these statistics. What is the average retaining time of each journal? After they get a journal, how quickly they decide on the article? So that important data to be taken. And don't get bogged down by the H index, you know. H index is, you know, it depends. H index is very subject specific. That means H index in computer science and H index in anthropology and H index in philosophy will be huge differences there. That means if you are working in cancer, then you will have a large H index. So H index is a little problematic in this issue. So don't get afraid of H index. You try to see, you make a target that you are publishing your paper in a index journal. That is important. SCIE, that is Science Citation Index Expanded, then Social Science Citation Index, then Arts and Humanities Citation Index. This is my message. Your journal should be one among these index journals.
I would like to, you know, put it in this way. Many young scholars, they are a bit hesitant, you know. They don't have big name and fame like Professor Pathy, and they are struggling hard to get their article published in cited journal, but they feel a fear complex. There is a fear complex. Okay, if I communicate my paper, I don't have that stature. So whether my article is going to get accepted in a very reputed journal, so how they will overcome this kind of fear psychosis? I'm putting it in on behalf of all the research scholars.
No, look here, that fear is not good. Nobody should fear. Because you see, initially I tried to send, that's my personal feeling I want to share. Initially I sent 3-4 articles to Nature and all of them were rejected. So then when I published this Good Morning Message paper, many of my friends said that, why are you publishing this journal? Why it didn't send to the Nature or Science? So this is a very important thing. That means sometimes a proper decision has to be made that in which journal it should your article should be communicated.
Pathy, our Honorable Vice Chancellor of Ravensa University, Professor Ishan Patro, would like to you know, ask you a question, or if he has something to say, he has requested me.
What I would suggest the young workers is, while you carry out your research, you have got different level of data available. Some of them are not very important and can be published in easy journals or less impact factor journals. Some of the data are not complete, but still they can be communicated. And something you are targeting to make a dent in the subject. So you should go on publishing some easy papers, some short notes, sometimes a review like that, and wait for the massive impact result to be published at a later date. So if you continuously go on publishing something, your tempo will be on and you can still wait for the best paper to come. See, two things cannot happen simultaneously. Early, quick, and the highest impact cannot come together. So if you want to have a very big impact of your work, you want to create a dent in your subject, you have to wait for a while, complete the work. In between, you always have some sideline information, sideline data, which you can send to other journals and publish them, and your interest continues. So a research scholar must go on publishing in different level of journals, always not in low impact, not in high impact. So you should not wait always for a high impact and lose your tempo. And also at the same time, you should not run after the number of papers. It's not important that how many papers you have, but it is very important how many people are citing your work, how many people are appreciating your work. That is exactly what I feel should be the message for the younger generations to do. And true, sir, I would have asked Dr. Atanupati the same thing. Your good morning data could have gone to Nature, but again, the same thing. The author actually assesses how quickly the message should be conveyed and how quickly the message should be there in the scientific community. Some of my seminal results could not find place in American journals, but was published in Indian journals are cited very high. So it depends at the time point how the author thinks. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Actually, I just want to add, thank you, Isham, Dr. Isham Patro. I just want to add one point that this is a message to the young people. Never think of publishing multiple publications. That means if you are doing one study, one research, one methodology, then you should not break that particular results into three or four parts and publish four papers. So these are known as multiple publications of the same study, of the same type of research. So someone will be speaking on ethical issues, so I don't want to, I didn't discuss much more in my presentation, but this multiple publication should be avoided.
No question from the scholar, so we'll wind up the lecture because many participants are leaving. I would like to thank once again on behalf of our university, and your lecture has made the online lecture series more vibrant. And thank you, sir, for contributing to the mainstream knowledge and educating our young researcher who have listened to your lecture carefully. And on behalf of our university, on behalf of our of the team, and two syndicates members are also present here. One is your good colleague. And I would like to extend our heartfelt thanks. Thank you very much.
I am obliged to you for providing me with this opportunity to speak on this occasion. And my heartiest congratulations to you as well. And this is a wonderful activity you are doing. And all the universities should do like this, the way
you are doing. Thank you very much, sir. We will.